Alhamdulillah alladhi abda' al-aflak wal-ardin والصلاه على من كان نبيا وادم بين الماء والطين وعلى اله واصحابه اجمعين اما بعد فاعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم صدق الله مولانا العظيم ببركة إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وسلم عليه الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا رحمة للعالمين One more time. الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا خاتم النبيين مولاي صلي وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير خلق كلهم يا رب بالمصطفى بلغ مقاصدنا واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع الكرمين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala The provider, sustainer, creator, cherisher, the one who we worship five times a day, and the one who gives even when we don't ask. And after sending infinite salutations and blessings upon our liege Lord and Master Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we shall begin. The awliyaullah, the friends of Allah, the asfiya, the ulama-i haq, each and every one of them, from the time of the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'een, till this very day, have certain qualities that they have in common. Awliyaullah is the jam'a of wali. And in English we know this is the friend of Allah. And these individuals, the first quality that they have in common is that they have combined sharia and ibadat with haqiqat and ma'rifat. You see, some people just have ilm. They don't have tasawwuf. Other peoples have tasawwuf, but they don't have ilm. Imam Malik rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh, who no doubt is amongst the awliyaullah. Imam Malik bin Anas radiyallahu ta'ala an wa rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh. They had a very profound saying, which sums up this first quality. A saying which is mentioned in the commentary, the shara of Huzur Data Ali Hujwari's Kashful Mahjub. Imam Malik rahmatullahi ta'ala alayh, they said the individual who has tasawwuf, spirituality, but he doesn't have ilm, knowledge, that individual is corrupt. He is corrupt. The one who is an abid but he isn't a alim, he is corrupt. And the one who is an alim, a knowledgeable individual, but he doesn't have tasawwuf and spirituality, ma'rifat and haqiqat, then that individual is gumrah, he is misguided. Imam Malik said, the individual who is chosen and selected by Allah and who is given mercies and blessings by Rasulullah is that individual who combines both shariat and haqiqat, and that individual is known as a wali. A wali has these two qualities in him, that he does jam'a between these two, between tasawwuf and ilm, and he becomes an embodiment of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Great individuals. And ye na samjo ja sahaba wa jus sahaba. Sahaba they were, companions they were, but each and every sahabi was a Sufi as well. People like the great Sayyiduna Abu Zal al-Ghaffari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Sahabi Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Their zuhd, their wara, their taqwa, their piety, their God-fearingness. If you read the books written by the great Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, Kitab al-Zuhd, other great books written by Imam Abu al-Qasim al-Qushayri, Risalat al-Qushayri, great books of tasawwuf, you will find that these sahaba were not just companions. They were not just individuals who were drowned in the ishq and muhabbat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But they were those individuals that they would spend the whole night in ibadat to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were those individuals who would fast during the day. They were those individuals who would give from whatever they had in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Zal al-Ghaffari radiallahu ta'ala and is the prominent sahabi who was considered to be the Sufi of his time. Great sahabi Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. This isn't the time or the place to go into the qualities of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. But we know Sayyidina Abu Bakr gave everything that he had in the way of Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or ek ijazat leki baat karana. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala an. Yes. This particular hadith is mentioned in the sunan of Imam Tirmizi radiyallahu ta'ala an. Rawi is Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, whose day is coming soon. Yes. The day of their visal, the day of their leaving this dunya is coming soon. Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Very mashur riwayat. That one day Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam made the announcement. They announced to the sahaba that which one of you will give in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayyidina Umar said to himself that today I will outdo Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Today I will beat Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Yes. So what did Sayyidina Umar do? He took all of his wealth, everything that he had in his home, and he divided it into two parts. One he left for his family, one he gave in the way of Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, Ya Umar, what is it that you have left for your family? Sayyidina Umar Farooq goes, Ya Rasulullah, I have left exactly what I have given in the way of Allah. At that point, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Afdalul Bashar Ba'dul Anbiya, the greatest individual after all of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is a reason why he is the greatest. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he heard the announcement of his Aqa and Mawla, when he heard the announcement of Sayyidul Anbiya'i wal Mursaleen, when he heard the announcement of Tajdari Medina, Nur Sina, Ahmad Mustafa wal Mujtaba, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq took everything that he had in his home. So much so that Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he took the buttons on his clothing and he replaced them buttons with thorns. Everything that he had in his home, everything that his children had, everything that his wife had, he gave in the way of Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam posed a question, that Ya Abu Bakr, what is it that you have left for your family? Yes. Tasawwuf started with the Sahaba. This is the point I'm illustrating. Spirituality isn't something which started centuries later after the time of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Ihsan, tazkiratun nafs, tazkiratun nufus, these principles, these concepts, these qualities the Sahaba had amongst them as well. And why wouldn't they have these qualities when the greatest teacher was teaching them these qualities? Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was instilling these qualities into the Sahaba. Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was asked this question, that Ya Abu Bakr, what is it that you have left for your family? Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq replied, that Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habiballah, abkayta lahumullah wa rasul. That I have left for my family Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This riwayat everybody has heard. This narration, everybody has heard. Highlighting the excellence of Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala. Imam Asakir, Ibn Asakir, or Imam Sulami radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, they continue the narration. Yes. And there is a maqsad behind this narration. Yes. When this particular occasion took place, or this event took place, that Abu Bakr has given everything in the way of Allah, at that point, Jibreel comes down on the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jibreel is wearing the clothing that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is wearing. Jibreel has thorns in the place of his buttons, just as Abu Bakr had thorns in the place of his buttons. And Jibreel comes into bargah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Jibreel comes into the bargah of Tajdar Madina, Nur Sina sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Jibreel says that Allah is asking Abu Bakr, that Abu Bakr, are you content with Allah? Are you radi with Allah? Are you happy with Allah? You see, there are two types of people. One person is he who looks to please Allah. He tries his hardest, his utmost, does ibadat, nawafil, fara'id. He fasts in the month of Ramadan. And then outside of the Ramadan, ultimately trying to seek the pleasure of Allah. That is one type of person. And then there is the second type of individual. And that individual is that Allah asks that person, are you happy with me? Khuda khud bande se pooche, bata teri raza kya hai? Allama Iqbal sums it up very beautifully. That khuda khud bande se pooche, that the Malik and the Khalik, the Creator and the Lord, he asks the person that, are you content with me? Nabi Salatu Wasalam calls Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, that hal anta an rabbika radin, that are you content with your Lord? At that point, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, this is all he wanted to hear. When your intentions are clean and pure, and when you do everything for the sake of Allah, then Allah ultimately rewards you. Hal anta an rabbika radin, that Ya Abu Bakr, are you content with your Lord? Are you content with your Creator? Are you content with Allah? At that point, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, Ana an Rabbi Radin, Ana an Rabbi Radin, Ana an Rabbi Radin. That indeed I am content with Allah, indeed I am content with Allah, indeed I am content with Allah. Yes. And the ulama, the sufiya, the awliya, they do shara of this particular narration. They go, this jumla, Ana an Rabbi Radin, is the first jumla tasawwuf in Islam. Tasawwuf began with Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala. Or when they were saying this statement, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq took the index finger on their right hand and they were doing this. They were going into a state of wajd. Ana an Rabbi Radin, Ana an Rabbi Radin, Ana an Rabbi Radin. And again, the ulama mentioned this was the first wajd in the bargah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The tasawwuf started with the Sahaba. And Sahaba were those individuals who combined Shariat and Hakikat together. And this legacy of the Sahaba was continued by the Awliyaullah, continued by great individuals like the great Marufi Qarqi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, like the great Ibrahim bin Adham radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, like the great Bishr al-Hafi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Individuals whose names, if I was to take, we'd probably be here till Isha anyway. And there is a maqsad why I'm starting like this. Imam Shafi kya kehte hain? Imam Shafi'i, people again, misconception. People think that the fuqaha, the great mujtahideen of this ummah, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, people think that they were just men of fiqh, that they were just men of sharia. They were just men of Quran and Hadith. And each and every single one of them, the four great Imams, they were Sufis as well. This isn't the time to go just into a little bit of detail maybe. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, who inshallah I will have the honor of speaking about in Walthamstow on Saturday. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, ye na samjo that he was just an alim, or he was just a mujtahid, he was just a scholar of the deen, he was just a faqih. Imam Abu Hanifa was a Sufi as well. Imam Abu Hanifa was that individual that for 40 years, they read Salatul Fajr with the same ablution that they had at the time of Salatul Isha. Ajkal ulama aisa karte? Nahi kar sakte. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi was that individual that in one night and every single night, Imam Abu Hanifa would read over 500 nawafil in the bargah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You samjhe that they were just fuqaha, that they were just scholars. Imam Malik rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, we know the adab and the ishq-e Mustafa and the reward and the sila of this is that Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam came every single night in the dream of Imam Malik rahmatullahi ta'ala. Imam Zahabi mentions this in his Sirul A'lam in Nubala. Why? Imam Shafi'i, who I mentioned, and the maqsad and the purpose of these gatherings, Imam Shafi'i sums up in one statement, that in the dhikr salihina tanazzalur rahma, that with the remembrance of the pious individuals, with the remembrance of the awliyaullah, with the dhikr, the tazkira of these great men of Allah, these men who had no fear, these men who had no grievance, ala inna awliya Allahi la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun alladhina amanu wa kanu yattaqun. Awliyaullah are those people who have no fear. No fear of loss of wealth and property and health. No fear of loss of aulad and biwi bache. Nothing. And they don't grieve when Allah tests them. When Allah sees how sincere are they in their love, they don't grieve. Awliyaullah are those people who believe wholeheartedly in Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Awliyaullah are those who have aqidah sahih, not aqidah corrupt. Awliyaullah are those who have a'mal hasana. They are not those individuals who are bera par log. Basji, take your hand in the hand of a sheikh and that's it. Assume that you are going to Jannat. Never will you find any of the awliyaullah, not a single one of them in the tariq of Islam, that they were bera par log. Awliyaullah were those individuals that the whole night they were spent in ibadat, that the whole day they would spend fasting. Awliyaullah were those individuals who had qualities like taqwa and wara. And this, these qualities Allah testifies to in the Quran. Awliyaullah wa kanu yattaqun are those who have God-fearingness, are those who have piety, are those who are constantly conscious that Allah is watching. Allah knows everything that we do. Allah knows the deep, dark, hidden secrets of our hearts. And when they do this and they overcome the nafs and the ego, then Allah gives them the silla as well. Allah gives them the reward as well. A reward which is again summed up in that jumla that I mentioned. In the dhikr salihina tanazzalur rahma. Allah goes, when you remember, Imam Shafi'i goes that when you remember these individuals, when you sit in these gatherings and you take the names of these great men of Allah, men like the great Imam Junaid Baghdadi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, men like the great Sari Sakati radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, men like the great Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri, who we are inshallah going to talk about as well, eventually. Yes? These great individuals, when you take their name, Imam Shafi'i goes, that mercy begins to descend upon you. Allah's rahmat begins to enter into your hearts. Allah's mercy and fadl, His karam nawazi begins to enter onto you, or begins to descend upon you and enter into your families and your homes, just by taking the names of these people. Yes. Awliyaullah are those people who have these qualities. And the last quality I'll mention before we look at that individual who had these qualities. And it's important that we understand this. The last quality, out of the many qualities I could have mentioned, is that the awliyaullah are those who are firm upon the sirat al-mustaqim. That they don't deviate from the sirat al-mustaqim. And you know, when we read Surah Fatiha in our Salah, when we read Surah Fatiha within our Salah, we say what? Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladhina an'amta alayhim minan nabiyyina wa siddiqina wa shuhadai wa salihin. That, O Allah, guide us upon the straight path, the path which you have favored for your chosen servants. Yes, I've done jam'ah of three verses of the Quran here. Yes. You know, some I read something else in my salah and you read something else in your salah. Yes. If you want to know who is upon the Sirat al Mustaqim, Allah gives you the answer as well. Man yuti illaha wa rasul. Yes. Those who are upon the Sirat al Mustaqim are those who obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those who obey Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. They don't deviate from this. And when they obey Allah and when they obey Rasulullah, فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ عَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showers His mercies upon these people. Allah showers His bounties upon these people. Allah showers His favors upon these people who obey Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They don't deviate from the Sirat al-Mustaqim. And Allah goes, when He showers His mercy upon these people, then ultimately on the day of Qiyamah, they will have company with the Anbiya. They will have company with the Siddiqeen. They will have company with the Salihin. They will have company with the Shuhada as well. And from amongst those who are Salih, from amongst those who are pious, is this individual who we are gathered to remember today. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. They were born 180 years after the hijrat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned in a hadith, muttafaqun alayhi, Bukhari Sharif, Muslim Sharif. The Shaykhain have mentioned this and narrated this. The Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, khayru ummati qarni, thumma allazina yalunahum, thumma allazina yalunahum. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that the best of my community, the greatest period, that period that Allah picks a qasam by in the Quran, wal asr. Mufassireen have mentioned that this time that Allah has picked an oath by is the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa said, the best of my community are my generation, my ashab, my companions. Then those who will follow them, the tabi'un. And then those who will follow the tabi'un, the taba tabi'un. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri is from amongst the taba tabi'un. Imam Malik passed away in 179. Yes. Dhu'l-Nun Misri was born in 180 after Hijrah. His full name was Sauban bin Ibrahim. Yes, and this research and information isn't something that you just come across on the internet. Sheikh Google and Mufti Facebook don't give you these answers. These answers are found in the books of Tasawwuf, where you have to do mutalia and research, where you have to sit at the feet of the ulama to unlock the secrets of these books. Yes, Imam Kushairi rahimahullahu ta'ala, who was the teacher of Data Ali Hujwairi rahmatullahi ta'ala. Yes. Imam Kushairi, they mentioned that his name was Thu'ban bin Ibrahim. Yes. Dhu'l-Nun was just a laqab which was given to him, was a title which was given to him, a kunya. Yes. Another title that he was known by was Abul Faid. Abul Faid. He was the father of Faid. Yes. And they were born in Upper Egypt. They were from Misr. Yes. Egypt. Blessed lands, which unfortunately today are full of turmoil and instability. We do dua that Allah gives istiqamah to the people of Misr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alleviates the suffering of the people of Misr. And the Muslim brothers and sisters who are suffering there, that Allah lessens their suffering. From these blessed lands of Misr, this great individual arose. And Imam Kushairi mentions that Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri radiyallahu ta'ala an fa'iqun fi haza al-sha'ni. That he was an individual. You see, a greatness of an individual is only realized when somebody else says you are great. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri came in the 2nd century. Abul Qasim al-Qushayri came in the 6th century.
Yes.
Or 5th century ghaliban. 300 years or so had passed. And Abul Qasim al-Qushayri's words, which will now live on till the day of Qiyamah. Fa'iqun fi haza sha'an. The Dhu'l-Nun Misri was an individual who excelled in tasawwuf and in spirituality. He was an individual who achieved the greatest rank in tasawwuf. And Abul Qasim al-Qushayri, they mention again, وَأَوْحَدُوا وَقْتُهُ عِلْمًا وَوَرَعًا وَحَالًا وَأَدَبًا. The Dhu'l-Nun Misri had 4 qualities which made him greater than everybody else in his time. And these 4 qualities we need to instill into our lives as well. These 4 qualities we need to pursue as well. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri, his first quality was that he had ilm. Again, ye na samjo the Sufi were just people who tasbih rolne aale, phook maarne aale. Those weren't real Sufis. Sufis are those who have ilm, who have knowledge. And when you drown yourself in the samundar of ilm, when you drown yourself in the ocean of knowledge, you come to that realization that Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned in the ahadith. Man arafa nafsahu faqad arafa rabbah. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, the one who recognizes himself. And how do you recognize yourselves? How do you come to this realization of your state? Is when you have knowledge. Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, Pirani Pir, Sayyid Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, they said the criteria an individual should judge himself by is knowledge. The more knowledge he has, the closer he becomes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dhu'l-Nun Misri, his first quality was knowledge. A quality which unfortunately today we have abandoned and forsaken. Ajkala said, knowledge is that you take a fatwa from Google. Knowledge is that you go on a course for 6 weeks, and then after that you're the greatest sheikh of your time. Ajkal ye ilm hai. Ajkal this is the way we value knowledge. But these ulama, these a'imma, these asfiya, awliya, sufiya, they were individuals who sacrificed their whole life in order to seek knowledge to please Allah. Allah's first command was what? Not to read salah. Not to fast in the month of Ramadan, that came later. Not to give zakat or do hajj. Allah's first hukam in the Quran was iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Allah's first command to the people through the wasila of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was tell the people, read in the name of your Lord who created you. Ya'ni Allah was telling you and me that seek knowledge. Al-ilmu khayrun min al-ibadah aw kama qala alayhi salatu wasalam. Nabi sallallahu alaihi said knowledge is greater than ibadat. Knowledge is greater than ibadat. Because knowledge gives you the tools in order to recognize the one who you are worshipping. And ilm then becomes a light for you. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, al-ilmu nurun. Aw kama qala alayhi salatu wasalam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, knowledge is light. Knowledge is nur. And knowledge, I'll tell you now, knowledge isn't through your laptops, through the internet. Knowledge only comes when you sit at the feet of the ulama. Knowledge is only when you make sacrifices and you go and seek knowledge. Don't wait for knowledge to come to you. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri was known to travel the lands of Arabia and the lands of Syria to just seek knowledge. Just to sit at the feet of the ulama. And this is the first quality Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri had. He was an individual who had knowledge. And we should become those individuals who have knowledge as well. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri was known for his wara. He was known for his taqwa. He was known for his piety. He was known for his God-fearingness. He was known for his God-consciousness. Again, qualities which you are unfortunately lacking today. I did a speech yesterday in East London on minor and major signs of the last hour. And as I was doing my mutaliyah yesterday, one of the minor signs of the last hour is that closer to the day of Qiyamah, people will become immoral in their behavior. There'll be no haya left. There'll be no gharat left amongst the people. There'll be no modesty left. Why? Why won't be there any modesty left? Why won't there be any haya left? Because ultimately people will stop fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People won't have these qualities of wara and taqwa. Qualities that the awliya and ulama's asfiya possessed in the bucket loads. The third quality Dhu'l-Nun Misri had was hal. Dhu'l-Nun Misri was an individual of spirituality. He was an embodiment of tasawwuf. From head to toe, he resembled the mission of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And again, spirituality, tasawwuf doesn't come by just sitting at home. Spirituality comes by sitting at the feet of your shuyukh. By sitting at the feet of your guide, your hadi, the one who will take your hand and take you into the bargah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is why Huzur Data Ali Hujwari rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, they mention in their Kashful Mahjub this concept of fanafil shaykh, fanafil rasul, fanafillah. And these men, these pious predecessors, who were from amongst the Salafus Salihun, they were shuyukh amongst themselves. They were individuals of tasawwuf themselves. And you will come to this realization. The Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, direct he would see Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam. Direct they would have the vision of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. These are qualities that Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala an, Thu'ban bin Ibrahim possessed. And the last quality, qualities that we should look to instill into our lives. And if we are, as parents, as grandparents, as uncles, as aunties, as mothers, if we don't have these qualities, then it is our duty and responsibility to instill these qualities into our children as well. And the biggest quality out of the qualities that Dhu'l-Nun Misri had was that he had adab. Har cheez adab se shuru hoti hai. Be adab, be naseeb, ba adab, ba naseeb. The one who has no adab, us ilm ka kya fayda? The one who has no respect towards his parents, what's the point in seeking knowledge? The one who has no respect towards his elders, what is the point of sitting at the feet of your ulama and the feet of your shuyukh? Everything starts with adab. At-talim, lihaza, for this reason, the downfall of shaitan was because he lacked adab. Allah says in the Quran, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. Iblis had ilm. He was the teacher of the malaika. He was the ustad of the angels. And Iblis had ibadat as well. Iblis worshipped Allah. So much so, there wasn't a single place where shaitan, Iblis, didn't do sajda in the bargah of Allah on this earth. Yes, he had these two great qualities of ilm and ibadat. But these qualities meant nothing in the bargah of Allah, because he lacks the most important quality, which is adab. That when Allah told the angels and ordered the angels to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, sajdatu ta'zeem, not sajdatul ibadat. Ye fark hai. Ibadat ka sajda, prostration or prostration of worship, is only like for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But sajda ta'zeem, Allah is teaching you and me, is possible even for a prophet of Allah as well. Allah ordered the angels to prostrate to Adam. Yes. Just a side point here. Imam Fakhruddin Razi rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, in the Tafsir al-Kabir, they mention the reason why Allah told the angels to prostrate to Adam is because on the forehead of Adam was Nur-e Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That on the forehead of Adam alayhi salam was Nur-e Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That the malaika, they were prostrating to Adam jismani tor, but ruhani and nurani tor, they were prostrating to Nur-e Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this nur that Allah then sent to the kainat. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 15. Aaj ka log inkar karne that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was a nur. People reject this concept. People who haven't studied, who haven't sat at the feet of the ulama. And these people, unfortunately, who lack adab, them people and shaitan have something in common. Because then Allah told the angels prostrate, Jibreel prostrate, Mikael prostrate, Israfil prostrate. All of them prostrated except Iblis. Why? Because he had this takabbur within him, this pride, this arrogance, I've achieved something. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri, radiyallahu ta'ala, and they had a very mashur quote, a very famous saying, that the one who thinks he is something, in the bargah of Allah, he is nothing. Dhu'l-Nun Misri ki baat kar rahe hai na? I know that I'm doing 3, 4, 5 channels at the same time, Sky and Digibox and Dodgybox. Different channels, but stay with me. Ye sab maqsad behind this mawzu. Ye tani, you just come listen to the story and walk away with no lessons. Walk away with no sabak. That you don't walk away with something to take with you. One is that you just narrate a story. What's the story in Balamori? Wouldn't you like to know? One is that you just said the story. The other is that you learn the maqsad of that person's life. Dhu'l-Nun Misri said what? The one who thinks he is something, in the bargah of Allah, he is nothing. But the one who thinks he is nothing, the one who humbles himself, the one who lowers himself, the one who overcomes his nafs and who overcomes his ego, the one who thinks he is nothing, in the bargah, in the court of Allah, he is something. Shaitan thought he was something. Allah said that your ibadat, your ilm means nothing because you lack adab. Yes. And those people like Dhu'l-Nun Misri who thought they were nothing, in the bargah of Allah, they were raised to a great maqam and a great rank and station. Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, the story behind his conversion. These were the four qualities he had. Ilm, wara, adab, or hal, tasawwuf, spirituality. Four qualities. If you take nothing with you today, apart from my cheesy joke, take this one sabak with you. These four qualities that we should look to instill in our lives. Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri, his tawbah, his conversion. Yes. Most of the Salafus Salihun, they had a reason behind why they came back onto this path. They came back onto the Sirat al-Mustaqim. We know famously the story behind Bishr al-Hafi radiyallahu ta'ala an. And people like Fudail ibn Ayyad radiyallahu ta'ala an. There was a reason behind their conversion. One day they were sitting and teaching their students. Who was teaching? Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri was teaching his students. At that point, again, Imam Qushayri mentions this in his Al-Risala. Yusuf bin Al-Husayn, he said that one day I was in the teaching session of Dhu'l-Nun Al-Misri radiyallahu ta'ala an. An individual came to him by the name of Salim Al-Maghribi radiyallahu ta'ala an. This individual asked that, Dhu'l-Nun, tell me, how did you come onto this path? How did you come onto the Sirat Al-Mustaqim? He goes, if I was to tell you, you will not be able to comprehend this. You will not be able to imagine this. You will not be able to imitate this. Salim said, you have to tell me. Tell me. Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri said that I wanted to go from old Cairo. Yes. Old Cairo to a village in Misr, in Egypt. On the way he goes that I fell asleep. These are Dhu'l-Nun Misri's words. He goes, I fell asleep in the desert. And as I was sleeping in the desert, I opened my eyes and I saw a small blind bird which had fallen from its nest. Small blind bird which had fallen from its nest. Yes. Suddenly, the earth opened. And from the earth came two bowls. One bowl was from gold, the other was made from silver. In one bowl there was food. In the other bowl there was water. Ma. Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he saw this blind bird given rizq and provision by Allah, He did tawbah in the bargah of Allah. He turned back to Allah. He goes, what I have seen is enough for me. Oh Allah, I repent in your bargah. I turn back to you. That you even provide for a blind bird as well. We are insan and our eyes are open. We see and you still give us as well. Ya Allah, I turn back to you and I repent. And Dhu'l-Nun Misri goes, and these are his words, that he waited in the bargah of Allah. وَلَزِمْتُ الْبَابَ إِلَىٰ أَنْ قِبَلَيْنِ Allah Azza wa Jal. That Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiallahu ta'ala, and he goes, that I waited in the bargah of Allah until he accepted me. This was his tawbah. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiallahu ta'ala an, he reached such high maqam and status that the people of Misr misunderstood him. The people of Misr insulted him, ridiculed him, attacked him. They called him a madman. They called him a heretic. They called him a kafir. They called him a mudhil. Yes. They gave him all these titles. Mulhid. They gave him all these titles. They accused him because they didn't understand his maqam. Yes. Just like Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam came to the people of Arabia, the mushriks of Arabia, those who had been worshipping the idols for thousands of years, hundreds of years. And when Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam came to them and gave them the message that Qul huwa Allahu ahad, that Allah is one, some accepted, some didn't accept. And the struggle that Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam went through 13 years in Makkatul Mukarramah, then in Madinatul Munawwara, this struggle, these hardships, these obstacles, these difficulties that Sayyid al-Anbiya wal Mursaleen went through, the ulama, awliya, sufiya went through these difficulties as well. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri was branded a kafir. People didn't understand his maqam, they didn't understand his status, they didn't understand his rank. Yes. But you see, people didn't understand him, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understood him. Yes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understood. And the reason why Allah allowed people to attack his people, those he had chosen, was Allah wanted to test them, to see how loyal they are in their love, how true they are to their claim. Sayyidina Fudail ibn Ayyad, again Imam Qushayri mentions, has a very famous saying, a saying which epitomizes the situation that Dhu'l-Nun Misri found himself in. That إِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا أَكْثَرَ غَمَّهُ, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves a servant, when Allah loves his people, then Allah increases difficulty upon them people. Allah tests them people. Allah gives them people hardships to see how loyal they are. And ultimately, when Allah gives them difficulty, when Allah tests them with hardships, then those people who are true and sincere, they have patience. Then Allah says, what in the Quran? Inna Allaha ma'as-sabirin. That indeed Allah is with those who are patient. Indeed Allah are with those who are forbearing. Indeed Allah are with those who are compassionate and merciful. But Sayyidina Fudail says, إِذَا أَبْغَدَ عَبْدًا وَسَّعَ عَلَيْهِ دُنْيَاهُ. But if Allah doesn't accept you, if Allah has this, hatred is a strong word, but if Allah doesn't accept you, if Allah rejects you, if Allah doesn't accept you as his servant, then what does Allah do? Allah increases the love of the dunya in your heart. Ye faisla karo, that if you love the dunya, assume that Allah doesn't love you. But if you have hatred for the dunya, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said what? Ad-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir. Aw kama qala alayhi salatu wassalam. Nabi salatu wassalam said, this dunya, this world, it is a prison for the believers. Why? Because he is denied this opportunity. He's denied this chance to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Nabi salatu wassalam said, This dunya, for the disbeliever, for the one who rejects Allah, for the one who turns against Allah, for the one who disobeys Allah, this dunya is jannat for him. Because he won't receive jannat in the akhirah. He didn't go through this taqwa, this wara. He didn't seek ilm. He didn't have this hal and kayfiyat. He didn't have haqiqat or ma'rifat. He didn't tread upon the sirat al-mustaqim. He didn't have khawf of Allah. Ultimately, he was a person who became engrossed in the dunya, the love of the dunya, the lures of the dunya, the luxuries of the dunya, the maal or dawlat of the dunya, the women of the dunya, the shahawat of the dunya. He was an individual who became engrossed in all of this. And if he did, Allah then denied his mercies. Allah denies his mercies to these people. Allah denies his bounties and blessings to these people. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri was branded a kafir. Suno, why? On this claim of the people of Misr, Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri was charged with heresy. He was charged with heresy. And he was summoned to the court of the Khalifa of the time, Khalifa Mutawakkil, yes, who was a caliph of the Abbasid Empire. Yes. They summoned Dhu'l-Nun Misri on these charges to Baghdad Sharif. Yes. During those times, the empire of the Muslims was centered in Baghdad Sharif. Dhu'l-Nun Misri traveled from Egypt to Baghdad in handcuffs. Yes. When he got to the bargah, to the courtyard of the king, the king imprisoned him for 40 days. The king imprisoned him for 40 days. Fariduddin Attar and many other books have mentioned this. Tazkiratul Awliya. Yes. For 40 days, Dhu'l-Nun Misri, Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri radiyallahu ta'ala an was imprisoned. During these 40 days, Dhu'l-Nun Misri didn't eat, he didn't drink anything. Every single day for 40 days, Chalidin, every single day, Sayyiduna Bishr al-Hafi's sister would provide food for Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri. 40 loaves of bread. Every day, one loaf. 40 days, 40 loaves. When Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri left the prison, in the corner were 40 loaves of bread. When Bishr al-Hafi's sister found out that Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri didn't eat the food that she had given to him, she asked, why? Why isn't it that you didn't eat the food that I gave you? That I put a lot of effort into this. The food that I gave you was halal, it was pure. It was earned through my hard efforts. Why didn't you eat this? Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri said, the food which you gave was pure, but the person who was giving it and the plate that it was given on was impure. Because of this reason, I didn't eat your food. This level of taqwa and wara. Socho, kana labna, chali din, didn't eat anything, didn't drink anything. Even though food was provided for him, he still didn't eat it. Because what it was provided on was impure. When the caliph of the time, Mutawakkil, he called Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri on these charges of heresy. Yes, Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri, when he was leaving his prison cell, he fell and he cut his forehead. But not a single drop of blood went onto his face, his hair or his clothes. That Allah allowed, Allah ordered the blood to stay where it was. This was a karamat of Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri radiyallahu ta'ala an. Then when he came into the bargah, the courtyard of the caliph of the time, al-Mutawakkil, they said that you've been charged with heresy. What is your response? Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri gave such a response, such a jami' and kamil response, that the khalifa, the caliph, his vizirs, his ministers, and everybody who was in his courtyard, they began to cry. They go that this person isn't a madman. This person isn't a kafir. This person isn't a heretic. This person is a man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna ma'al usri yusra, that indeed with difficulty comes ease. People branded him these things, but they didn't respond, they didn't retaliate. Yes. And ultimately Allah then rewarded him, that even the Khalifa of the time, the leader of the mu'mins, the Amir al-Mu'mineen of the time, even he accepted that he was a Sufi of his time, that he was a man of Allah of his time. And every single time, after these charges, they were dropped. He was sent back to Misr, yes, with high honors and high dignity. And then afterwards, every time Dhu'l-Nun Misri's name was mentioned in front of Mutawakkil, the Caliph of the time, he would begin to cry. He would begin to cry because he would remember the eloquent speech of Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri, how did he get this name Dhu'l-Nun? Dhu'l-Nun is the man of fish, or the possessor of fish. How? This laqab, this title. One day Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was traveling on a boat. And this boat was full of merchants. And one of the merchants, he had lost his jewel. So what they did was a body search. Every person who was on the boat, they searched him. And they came to the conclusion, nobody has the jewel. But the last one to step on the boat was Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiallahu ta'ala. That he must have the jewel with him. So they began to search him. They began to persecute him. They mistreated him. At that moment, Dhu'l-Nun Misri made the alarm that, oh Allah, you know who has the jewel. As soon as he said this, thousands of fish came out from the river, came out from the water, and each and every fish had a jewel in his mouth, or in its mouth. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri took one of his jewels, gave it to the people, and then he left by walking on the water. This was again another one of his karamat. And this was how he received this title, Dhu'l-Nun, the man of fish. That Allah protected his servant. Allah looked after one of his people, one of his chosen men. That when his people are in trouble, Allah is the one who looks after his people. La khawfun alayhim. That there is no fear for them because they know Allah is protecting them. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri one day was coming back from Jerusalem, Baytul Muqaddis. Huzudat Ali Hujwari rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi mentioned this particular riwayat in the Kashful Mahjub. That they were coming back from Jerusalem and they came across a Arifa. Yes, an Arif is a male, Arifa is a female. Ya'ni somebody who was recognized Allah Azza wa Jal. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiallahu ta'ala an, he posed this question to this woman, this old woman, frail woman. She was wearing a jubba, she had a asar, a staff with her. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri said, where is it that you've come from? Ghorsi sunna the jawab. Where is it that you've come from? This old woman goes, I have come from Allah. I have come from Allah. Dhu'l-Nun Misri goes, where is it that you are going? She goes, I am going to Allah as well. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. That indeed we came from Allah and ultimately we will return to Allah as well. At that moment in time, Dhu'l-Nun Misri put his hand in his jubba and he took out some coins and gave it and offered it to this old lady. She goes, Dhu'l-Nun, you are a madman. Yes? You never understood what I said. She goes, I only take from Allah. I came from Allah. I shall return to Allah. I only take from Allah. I only accept from Allah. That whatever He gives me, that is what I accept. Whatever He doesn't give me, I don't accept. And whatever the people offer, I don't accept as well. I reject. She goes, I only take from Allah. We need to ask ourselves. The great lengths we go to in order to have more wealth, in order to have properties, in order to drive the best cars. The lies we have to tell, the trust we have to break, the amanat we have to breach, the difficulties we, in this case, ease that we have to go through just to get the best in life. This Arifah is teaching you and me a lesson that ultimately we come from Allah. We return to Allah and everything comes from Allah as well. Have this tawakkul, this trust in Allah. That only seek from Allah, only accept from Allah Jalla Jalalahu. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. One day they were traveling on a boat on the River Nile, a famous river in Egypt. They were traveling on this boat. With them were their muridin, their disciples. Sheikh Nakam is to give tarbiyah to his muridin. Another boat was approaching. And on this particular boat, there were young men who were making merry. Yes. They were using musical instruments, nacha, these kind of things. The muridin of Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala an, they said, Huzur, make dua that Allah ruins these people. Tabah ho jaye na bandeni. That Allah ruins these people. At that point, Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri goes, Theek, as you say, you raise your hands, I will raise my hand. Whatever dua I make, you say Ameen. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri raised his hands and he made the dua that, oh Allah, just as they are happy in this dunya, let them be happy in the akhirah as well. Murid was shocked. Huzur asa ahya do dua that they are ruined. Tabao ijai. And you do dua that Allah give them hushi in this dunya, give them hushi in the akhirah. Huzur, iska majra kya hai? Iski hikmat kya hai? What's the reason behind this? What's the wisdom behind this? Huzur Dhu'l-Nun al-Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he goes that a person of Allah never curses the people of Allah. Allah ka banda never does badwa for the people of Allah. Ye pehli gal hai. Dhu'l-Nun Misri is saying that we never curse people. This is Sunnat Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That the mushriks were attacking Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam at the Battle of Uhud. Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, make the dua that Allah ruins these people. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam raised his hand and said, Oh Allah, my people do not know. Oh Allah, have mercy and compassion upon my people. And the awliya, sufiya, asfiya, and something that I've been trying to illustrate throughout this speech. The awliya, sufiya are those who are embodiments of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The qualities that Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam had, the awliyaullah also had these qualities. Huzur Khwaja Khwaja Khan, Khwaja Mu'inuddin, Sayyid Mu'inuddin Chisti, Ajmeri Sanjari, Rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. After they conquered Hindustan and they became Sultanul Hind, Sultanul Ajmer. One day somebody came with the intention to kill them. So they had the dagger in the jubba and they knocked on the door of Huzur. Khwaja Khwaja Khan, Sayyid Mu'inuddin Chisti, Rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ittaqu firasat al-mu'min fa innahu yanzuru bi nurillah." The fear, the insight of a believer, for indeed he sees with the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khwaja Khwaja Khan opened the door. They looked at this individual who had come with the intention to kill them. They looked at this individual from head to toe. They said, "Do what it is that you have come to do. Do what it is that you have come to do." Uwe waqia yaad aa rahi hai na. None of this has prepared, just off the top of my head. Baithiyo, zohk ki gal kandiya. Uwe waqia yaad aa rahi hai na. Sayyiduna Fudaila radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. The sahabi who was intending to kill Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. He was doing tawaf. Every time Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam asked, Fudaila, are you okay? Naam ya Rasulullah, I'm okay. After they had finished doing tawaf, Fudaila, I know what it is that you have come to do. At that point, Fudaila dropped his knees in the bargah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam took their blessed hand and placed it on the chest of Fudaila. And the hal and the kayfiyat and the vijdan of Fudaila changed. So much so that Fudaila became sahabiya Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. Khwaja Khwaja Khan said that do what it is that you have come to do. At that point, this individual who had this dagger in his sleeve, he dropped this dagger and he fell at the feet of Khwaja Khwaja Khan. He was at the mercy of Khwaja Khwaja Khan. Khwaja Khan just had to raise his hands. Allah doesn't reject the dua of a wali. Khwaja Khan didn't do badwa. They did dua for this individual. And the books of Tasawwuf and Tariq mention that this man who Khwaja Khan did dua for, he had the tawfiq and the ability to do hajj over 40 times in his lifetime. When the men of Allah do dua for you, Allah never rejects this dua. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri made this dua that, oh Allah, give them happiness in this dunya. Or give them happiness in the akhirah just as you are giving them happiness in this dunya. As soon as this boat approached the boat of Dhu'l-Nun Misri, these young men who were making noises and who were doing things which were inappropriate, all they did was look at the face of Dhu'l-Nun Misri and they fell at the feet of Dhu'l-Nun Misri. Each and every one of them did tawbah and each and every one of them became a wali as well. When the man of Allah does dua for you, doesn't get rejected. Each and every one of them became a wali in the bargah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala an was an individual who had very profound sayings, famous sayings. One I've already mentioned, the one who thinks he is something in the bargah of Allah, he is nothing. But the one who thinks he is nothing, who humbles himself, who lowers himself, he is something in the bargah of Allah. Very quickly, Sayyidina Fudail, or Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala an, they said that madarul kalami ala arba, that the foundation of speech are four. That when you speak, you should speak only in four cases. Hubbul jaleel wa bughdul qaleel wa ittiba'un tanzeel wa khawfut tahweel. Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri goes that when you speak, only speak first out of the love of Allah. Only speak out of the love of Allah. There was a woman in the time of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mubarak radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who for 30 years, all she did was speak out of Quran and Sunnah. 30 years. The only conversation she had was from Quran and Sunnah. Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun is teaching you and me that when you speak, you only speak out of the love of Allah. Speak good. فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ أَوْ كَمَا قَالْ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ Nabi al-Islam, Bukhari Sharif ki hadith, Nabi al-Islam says, speak good or remain silent. Aaj kal jo kuch aata na, woh kuch hi karne na. Backbiting, ghibat, chugli, lying, gossiping, sanding, spreading lies. Nabi al-Islam says, speak good or remain silent. If you have nothing good to say, speak. Don't speak. Khubbul jaleel, wa bughdul qaleel, hatred for the dunya. When you speak, speak out of your hatred for the dunya. Yes. Ajkal. We only speak for our love of the dunya, our chasing the dunya, our wants of the dunya, our desires for the dunya. Dhu'l-Nun Misri goes that when you speak, only speak for your hatred of the dunya. Third thing, that when you speak when you're following the Quran. Ittiba'ul tahzeel or tanzeel. That when you speak only what the Quran says. This is why Sayyidah Aisha Siddiqa, when she was asked that, how is the character of Nabi Salatu Wasalam? Aisha Siddiqa radiyallahu ta'ala anha, she replied, kana khulukuhul Quran. That his character is the Quran. That whatever the Quran has commanded, that is what Nabi Salatu Wasalam does. And whatever the Quran has forbidden, that is what Nabi Salatu Wasalam stays away from. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ This is the why Allah picks a qasam by the character of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And the last thing, وَخَوْفٌ تَحْوِيلٌ That when you speak out of this fear of changing from bad into good. That if you speak wrong, you know that you'll change from a good person into bad. Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri said, مِنْ عَلَامَاتِ مُحِبِّ لِلَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلٌ مُطَابَعَتِهِ حَبِيبِ اللَّهِ فِي أَخْلَاقِهِ وَأَفْعَالِهِ وَأَمَارِهِ وَأَمَامِرِهِ وَأَوَامِرِهِ وَسُنَنِهِ Yes. Sayyidina Dhu'l-Nun Misri said that from the signs of the love of Allah, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّنَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي Yes. From the signs of the love of Allah is that you follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اتِّبَاعُ النَّبِي sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That you follow Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Why? لَقَدْ قَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا Because he, Sayyid al-Anbiya'i wal-Mursaleen, is the best of all examples. He is the perfect role model. That if you want somebody to follow, then you follow Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. You do ittiba'un Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam in his akhlaq, in his character, in his manners, in his actions, in his orders, and in his sunnah as well. In his sunnah as well. Zahiran, you follow the sunnah of Nabi alayhi salam. Batinan, you follow the sunnah of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. And you become people who embody the ishq and muhabbat of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. The people look at you and they go, there goes a ghulam of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. There goes an ashik of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Because you never wrong anybody. You never do zulm against anybody. You never wrong or oppress anybody. You do whatever Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam has told us to do. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri said, Tawbatul awam takunu minaz zunub. Wa tawbatul khawas takunu minal ghafla. That the repentance of the armed people, the repentance of you and me, is that we repent from our sins. But the repentance of specific people, khas people, is that they repent from negligence. They repent from ghaflat. Yes. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri, last thing, and then we'll just come to the death and I close there. La taskunul hikmatu ma'iddatan muli'at ta'aman. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri said, wisdom, hikmat, doesn't enter into that individual whose stomach is full. Kai 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 ta bas. Dakar mari ta udri paasa mari jande. Us bande vich kisra hikmat achcha hai. Us bande vich kisra taqwa achcha hai. Sufiya mentioned three qualities that every person should strive to achieve. Sleep less, eat less, talk less. Aaj kal aisa dor aa gaya, we eat more, sleep more, and we talk more. Yes? Hikmat doesn't lie in that person who has a full stomach. Yes. This is why Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Ra'sul hikmati makhafatullah. That the root of wisdom, the root of hikmat, the foundation of hikmat is the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more fear you have Allah, the more hikmat and wisdom you will have from Allah. The less fear you have, the less hikmat you will have. Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri left this dunya on the 26th of Sha'ban, 246 years after Hijrah. 66 years of age. 180 they were born, 246 they left this dunya. The night before they left this dunya, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came into the dreams of over 70 awliyaullah. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came into the dream of over 70 awliyaullah. Each and every one of them asked that, Ya Rasulullah, why is it that you have blessed us with your diadar? Why is it that you have blessed us with your vision? Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, the reason why I've come is that I've come to receive the soul of Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala. That I've come to do the istiqbali of Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala. 70 awliya had this didar of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The ziyarat of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the day he died, the day Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala and left this dunya, Allahu Akbar. Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he left this dunya, written on his forehead was that this is a friend of Allah. This is a friend of Allah. He died in the love of Allah. This is the slain of Allah by the sword of Allah. This was written in green on the forehead of Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala. And the people, they carried his coffin from his house to the graveyard. And that day was a very warm day, a very hot day. By the grace of Allah and the power and the qudrat of Allah, thousands of birds came and they used their wings in order to shade the coffin of Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala. Inna ma'al usri yusra. Puri zindgi. People were doing tana, meena. People were calling him a kafir, a madman. And look now, the day he has left this dunya, Allah has given him izzat and honor. Thousands of birds come and they have flocked the coffin of Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala. And whilst the people of Misr are taking his body to the graveyard, the azan is called. Just as the azan will be called now. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. When the Muazzin said this jumla, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Dhu'l-Nun Misri raised his finger from his coffin. The people who were carrying his grave, who were carrying his coffin, they lowered his coffin, they checked to see, is he alive? Has he left this dunya? What's the reason behind this? That he's raised his kalima, his finger of shahadat. when they check that he has left his dunya, each and every person who had made his life a misery, they did tawbah in the bargah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only then did they realize the greatness of Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And then they took him to the graveyard. They lowered this great individual. And then ultimately, Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was reunited with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the life of Dhu'l-Nun Misri in a nutshell. Yes. Take those qualities with you. Those four qualities that Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun has. Yes. Ilm, wara, hal, or adab. Take these if you don't take anything else with you. And try your utmost to instill these qualities into your life. And instill these qualities into the life of your children. And the asal haqiqat of Islam lies with the awliyaullah. I'll end how I started. The asal haqiqat of Islam lies with the awliyaullah. The men of Allah, the friends of Allah, they are the true role models. Yes, I'll take a line out of my brother's speech now. It's not your pop stars and your movie stars, your footballers and your sports stars. These people are just mundane, temporary people. Asal haqiqat lies with these people who spent their whole life in the remembrance of Allah. And then Allah, after they have left this dunya, remembers them. Fazkuruni azkurkum. Puri zindagi. Banda fanayana. Lekin huda baqi. Huda is baqa. He has this attribute, this quality. That banda is fana. His zikr, his life comes to an end. 30, 40, 50 years, whatever Allah has decreed. But when you spend your life remembering Allah, then as soon as you leave this dunya, Allah remembers you. Azkurkum. Yes. So remember Allah, as Sayyiduna Dhu'l-Nun Misri radiyallahu ta'ala and remembered Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to act upon the life of this great individual. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ